56. Shall we? And Brother Sam, would you pray for us tonight, please?
Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for the good service we had this morning, Lord. I pray that you would help us to be attentive tonight as well, Lord. In your name, pray.
Amen. Thank you. May we see. Let me give you a couple announcements again this evening and to remind you of the activities of the week. Tomorrow is our work day at the chapel outside, as long as it's not raining. And there's a few folks here to try to show up about 1 o'clock tomorrow afternoon. And then throughout the day, if you want to come throughout the day and into the evening, as long as somebody's there. Our big thing tomorrow is going to kind of get the yard picked up. There's overgrown weeds in the bushes, things like that, and flower beds. There's a place where the mulch is there. We're trying to pull the weeds out of there and rake out the old mulch. And I'm going to put in some new mulch here and do some trimming around the sidewalks and pull the weeds out of the parking lot, just kind of dress it up. And so those are things that we're doing tomorrow, and then hopefully get into the building here real soon and begin getting that painted and cleaned up and ready to go for our July the 3rd service. And we're also passing out flyers the next several weeks. And so we have 10,000 of these flyers printed up, ready to go. And so there's boxes downstairs. They come in packs of 250 in the box. And so if you're interested in taking some of these and passing those out, let me know. We can pass them out throughout the week. We'll be doing a big push on Saturdays and also on afternoons on Sundays. If you're wanting to go out on Sunday afternoons for a little while, we can do that as well. And so I was out this afternoon for just a little while passing out some flyers and had kind of a mixed reception. Had a few folks that were excited about it and good to hearing about it, and the other folks like, we ain't going to that. And so anyway, get some of these and pass them out. And if you're thinking about it, maybe you can put them in stores, things like that, on bulletin boards. So that would be a great thing to do. And so be in prayer about our chapel ministry as we get closer to that. It'll be a lot of work on Sundays for us and Thursday nights, but looking forward to reaching the area. And as you go down there and pass out flyers, there is such a great need in our city, all over, no matter where you go, people everywhere. And I'm looking forward to God doing a great work and reaching people for the cause of Christ. Then don't forget then on Friday night is our men's prayer at 9 o'clock. We'll try to do it at the chapel if we can. And then on Saturday morning at 8:30 is our planning meeting. And I'd like to meet with all the folks who are going to be a part of the chapel ministry on a regular basis. And I'd like to get people scheduled, or the cleaning schedule, things like that. And so if you're not interested, maybe helping on Sunday or Thursday, we will need folks cleaning the building too throughout the week. And my long-term plan is, my long-term goal or hope is, that as we launch things and people start getting involved in that, that the folks coming to that chapel service will actually also be part of our cleaning crew and our help and sing specials. And so we want them to make that part of, I just don't want to have two Old Paths Baptist churches doing the same thing over and over again. And so my goal is to have them get involved too, but they'll need help and training along the way. And so that's the long-term goal. So if you can help that, would that be a blessing? And then of course, 10 o'clock is our gospel bus. And at that time as well, we'll be passing out flyers. And so if you want to pass out flyers Saturday morning, meet us down there in the parking lot at the chapel, and we'll get you started from there. Mission of the week this week is the Edminster family in Postville. Be in prayer for him as they push forward in Postville, and also I believe New Hampton. And is it Hampton or New Hampton? New Hampton, and trying to start a church over there as well. And so be in prayer for them too. And then, let's see, birthdays of the week this week is Caleb Porter on the 11th, and also Jacob Underwood the same day on the 11th. And then we are, of course, I'm not big on raising finances, and I just believe that God knows what we need, and so I don't like to mention a whole lot. But the bucket here on the front, that's for our chapel ministry. And so whatever goes in that bucket, you can put it in an envelope and put missions on it, or put chapel and put it in the box. It'll go to the chapel. But that bucket is for our chapel ministry as well. And whatever goes in there goes to the chapel. And so we're going to have quite an expense as far as startup expense. We're going to have to buy, of course, small appliances for this chapel and cleaning supplies and things like that to get started. So there's going to be initial cost. I believe our sign down there is going to cost us close to $3,000 to get a sign put up. And that's due to on the inexpensive side. The original quote was 10 grand to get a lighted sign put up. And so we're going to kind of cut some corners initially and see what God does that way. So there's going to be initial costs. And, of course, then our monthly rent lease. And so it's going to cost us. And so that bucket will be, of course, just for that. But I appreciate folks. And God has been good every step along the way so far. There's always been money in the coming in. We've had folks in the community send us money. They heard about it, wanted to help us out. And churches have sent us money. And so to me, it's obvious that God is helping us along the way. And so we're probably never going to have $1 million in an account just waiting there for us to spend it. It's going to come in little by little as God always does it. So we live by faith. But that bucket will be for that. And so if you feel led to give, that's a good place to do that. So I appreciate all the church's help. And our most important thing is your prayers. If you could pray that God will bless and see people saved, that would be the most important thing. So that's why we're doing what we're doing. So thank you for coming out tonight.
Let's turn to 202. 202. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Smile. God's praise than when we first begun. Let's turn to 394, and everybody stand together. 394. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour in joy or pain. Come quickly and abide, or life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Matt. Appreciate that. Take your Bibles tonight and turn again to Book of Romans, chapter number 7, please. Romans chapter 7 in your Bibles. And I want to preach tonight again on winning spiritual battles. And we're going to look at another aspect of the battle that we fight against within ourselves. Romans chapter 7. And let's begin in verse number 14. Kind of pick up at the end of the chapter. And we'll read Paul's struggle within himself. Verse number 14, verse number 25. It says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin." It'd be a good day in the life of Christians when we get real with ourselves and realize what we really are. I think that we give our strengths too much credit. We don't pay enough attention to our weaknesses and our own fleshly nature. And the house of God today is suffering because Christians are too proud and in need of nothing when we are in need of everything. We're in need of Christ. Verse number 15 says, here's Paul's struggle now that we want to talk about tonight. Verse number 15, "For that which I do allow not, for what I would that I do not, but what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law," now watch it now, "that it is good." That's a great verse to look at, great truth to understand. "Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing." He's not talking about his neighbor. All right? The guy across the pew. He's talking about himself. "For in me." That'll help you have more compassion on others when you realize that in you dwells no good thing. Now here's tonight our struggle. "For to will is present with me, But how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law, that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to a law of sin which is in my members. Here's Paul's exclamation now. O wretched man that I am. That's when you're nigh unto victory. When you're to that point, you're almost to victory. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh the law of sin. We're going to stop there, but the context goes on to chapter number 8 about victory. But we'll talk about that here in a moment. Father, help us tonight, I pray. Give us great understanding of your word. Father, give me, Lord, the ability to deliver your word in a manner that's helpful and encouraging, Father, in accordance with your will. Bless this place, Father. We need you tonight. We ask you, Lord, that we'd recognize your presence here tonight and allow you to speak to our hearts as we pray in your holy name. Amen. We're talking about the last several Sunday evenings that the Christian has as adversaries. We are in a spiritual battle every day of our lives. We have adversaries. We have the world as our adversary. The world hates the things of God and cannot do the things of God. And so the world, this influence, its pull, is our adversary. And by the way, God said if we're a friend to the world, we're also his adversary. You can't be friends with both God and the world at the same time. We find then that the devil, according to 1 Peter 5, that the devil is also our adversary. Peter said that he is as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so he is our adversary, but thank God he can't be only one place at one time. He's not everywhere at one time. He does not know our thoughts. All right, he doesn't know our thoughts. He can plant thoughts in our mind, as he did with Peter and others, but he doesn't know our thoughts. And I've heard people say, you know, you should pray quietly or pray in your mind because the devil will hear your prayers and hinder them. I don't never find that in the Bible where you have to pray quietly. I think you can cry out to God out loud and he'll hear your prayers. And the devil can sometimes intercept prayers as far as blocking some answers to prayers. We find that in the Old Testament. Anyway, that's just a little side note. But the devil is our adversary. But I think the adversary that causes us the most trouble in our lives, the person that we look at in the mirror every morning, right, ourselves, our flesh. And so I've broken down our adversary. I've broken it down in a couple different facilities. I've talked about our flesh, that part of us that is always, according to the book of James, that lusteth to envy. Our flesh is never content or satisfied. We're never happy with what we have, it seems like, in our fleshly nature. In our flesh, according to Galatians chapter 5, our flesh, if we let our flesh run away with us, then the works of the flesh, of course, are fornication and adultery and all kinds of perversion and immorality. And so our flesh lusts after the things of the world, after evil things. And so we can get victory over the flesh. I then spent some time last Sunday night talking about victory over our thought life. And our thought life, what goes on in our mind. And by the way, what goes on in your mind is, it may be, it's different than our flesh, but it's sinful as well. Thinking bad thoughts and entertaining bad thoughts and hating people in your heart and unforgiveness and bitterness is just as sinful in the eyes of God as the sins of the flesh. Right. Now again, when I commit a sin in the flesh, I'm going to involve other people in that matter. And it's not like, well, I thought it, so I might as well do it. Well, that's dumb too. And so, but the sins of the flesh and the sins of the heart would all send a person to hell, take us out of God's will with our life. And so we said last Sunday night that to get victory over the thought life is to expel sinful thoughts, according to the book of 1 Peter. Have a filter for our thoughts. Number two, I said employ spiritual weapons. Get in God's word. Use prayer. I said eliminate harmful speech. And so when we begin to speak things, it will oftentimes put in motion what we think. And then I said last Sunday night, to engage in spiritual work. God says that commit our works unto Him and He shall establish our thoughts. What you occupy yourself with, you'll begin to also dwell about and think about. Tonight I want to talk a little different topic that I don't often hear preached about. We include this topic oftentimes in the sins of the flesh or the sins of the heart or mind. Tonight I want to talk to you about getting victory over the will, your will. The place in your life, the will, listen, the flesh is our old nature. It's the carnal nature. It's a part of ourself that lusteth to envy. The mind is our thought life. And we don't always act upon our thoughts. Thank God for that, right? When we think, I'm going to kill that guy, it's just a thought, not an action, right? I hope so. But our will is a part of us that makes the decision to act upon our thoughts and our ideas. The will is our intent. It's our purpose. It's our determination. It's the part that actually puts in action our thoughts and our ideas. And Paul had a problem with his will. He said, it's my will. He goes, I want to do right. I will to do right. But the struggle that I have with me, though I will to do right and I want to do right, I find myself, my will, getting away from me. The things that I hate, those are the things that I do. The things I want to do, those are things I don't do. And so Paul confronts himself as his own adversary. Verse 18, he says, For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, will have no good thing. Paul makes the admission now that he had a problem with his flesh and with his mind. In me dwells no good thing. I've got a problem. And again, we're good as people. We're good as people to recognize the problem in others. In others. Hardly anybody ever calls me and says, preacher, I've got a problem with me. Very seldom. It's usually, I got a problem with somebody. Right? Right? I never come to you and say, I got a problem with me. Do I? Never. I never said, listen, help me, I got a problem with me. No, I always got a problem with you or somebody else. And so we're prone to see other people's problems. We make their problems really big and ours, you know, well, they ain't so bad. And so Paul confronts himself with, I've got a problem with my flesh, with my mind. His flesh was carnal and his thoughts were contrary to godliness. But he also faces a battle of the wills, right? Battle of the wills. And you'll face that all the time, it seems like, through your life. Verse number 18 and 19 says this. He says, verse number 19 says, for the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do. So he has a problem with the wills, the will to do right and the will to engage in sin. And so his intent to do right, He wanted to do right, but his performance was less than desirable. At the altar on Sundays, he would come to the altar and say, I'm going to give my life to Christ. I'm going to start a brand new life. I'm starting all over. Monday's going to be a brand new day. I'm going to commit myself and do right and away with that sin, away with that those bad choices. Then come Monday night, he's right back into what he went to the altar for on Sunday morning. And many of us have been there. And we hear the word of God preached, and we're in the song service, and Spirit of God begins to work in our hearts, and boy, He brings to our mind that sin, that evil thought, that our will, and we come to an altar. Well, some of us come to the altar, and we come to an altar, and we're like, God, I'm sorry, forgive me, I'm going to commit my life to You again. I'm not going back. And boy, you wake up maybe on Monday morning, like, boy, I'm glad I made that choice. Then by Monday night, Tuesday or so, the devil just gets working in your life, and all of a sudden that will to do right is overtaken by the will to engage in sin, and you find yourself battling the wills, and you're right back to where you began Sunday morning. And Paul, he said, that's my problem I'm having. I want to do right, but there's a battle between the wills. We find this truth in the same throughout the Word of God. This same truth is that Christ spoke about with his disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember that Peter and the disciples, of course, and John were in the upper room with the Last Supper. And boy, what a supper it was. I mean, it was a spiritual time when they ate the Last Supper with Christ. He washed their feet. They went out and they prayed and they sang hymns together. And then Christ says, tarrieth me for just an hour and pray with me for an hour. And he went a little farther and he prayed and he came back and he found them, his disciples, sleeping. He's like, hey, wake up. Boys, this is the hour of prayer. Can you just, with 1 hour, just for 1 hour, tarry with me, pray. And what did he say to the disciples? He said, watch and pray that you're not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He recognized there's a battle of the wills. And no doubt that Peter and James and John, when they went out to the Garden of Gethsemane, didn't go out there and say, hey, let's go out there and take a nap. Let's sleep as Christ is praying. No doubt their will was to let's go out there and pray. But boy, they found themselves just a few minutes heavy with sleep. And though Christ was just a few feet away from them praying with great anxiety or great grief and sorrow, with great blood, with blood dropping from his brow, they were fast asleep. A battle of the wills. Battle of the wills. And so, by the way, speaking about sleeping, sleeping at the wrong time, in the wrong places, with the wrong people will get you into big trouble. Isn't it amazing that as you go through the Word of God, that sleeping got some folks in trouble? Yeah, Peter and James and John here. What about Samson? Yeah, he got a little trouble sleeping at the wrong time, in the wrong place, with the wrong person. Be careful where you're going to fall asleep at, by the way. You might find yourself in a little trouble. Now, I want to give you tonight kind of a lengthy introduction. I want you to see some truth in Romans 7, and then we're going to try to make some practical application with it in the book of Timothy. So let's go to work here tonight, and let's look at Paul's conversation here, and he reconciles this battle of the wills with the Word of God. Paul's confrontation with his adversary and confession of his struggles wasn't a white flag of surrender to sin. Say that again. This was not Paul surrendering to sin. We have this idea today that as long as my heart intends to do right, my actions don't matter. Paul's not saying because I will, I have a battle of the wills and I want to do right and my heart's to do right, but I find myself doing what I hate. I find myself doing those things. So what's the use? I'm all just, as long as my heart wants to do right, it makes a difference how my flesh lives. He's not saying that. But that's where many folks live. Many folks think, well, as long as my heart is right, then my actions don't matter so much. Let me tell you something. If your heart is right, you'll be ashamed of your sin. Paul said, oh, wretched man that I am. He didn't say, hey, just be happy and eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. No, he said, listen, I've got a problem here. It bothers me. I'm ashamed of it, and I need God's help. I need God's help. There's a misunderstanding of grace. People today misunderstand grace. They think that grace says, since I live under grace, as long as my heart is right, my actions don't matter. But Titus 2, 11 and 12 says that grace teaches us to deny all ungodliness. Grace doesn't give us a license to say, this follow your will, follow your flesh. No, grace teaches us the very opposite. If your heart is right, you'll be ashamed of your sin. That's for sure. Now, winning over the will of our lives, of our heart, requires understanding of the Word of God, of the law. Look at verses 12 with me. Verses 12, it says here. Here's what Paul says now about the law of Moses, the law of the Word of God. Wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, just, and good. Paul never writes anywhere in the scripture that the law of God is bad. He didn't say anywhere, ignore the Ten Commandments. He didn't say anywhere, they're not for us today. In fact, he says in verse number 14, he says, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I'm carnal, sold under sin. For that which I do, I allow not. But what I hate, that I do. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Paul's saying this. You know, whenever man says, boy, I shouldn't do that. know what they're saying? The law is good. That's man saying, I'm convicted. Listen, if the law didn't matter, if the thou shalt not didn't matter, if the word of God wasn't written upon, if the laws of God were written upon nature and upon our heart, there would be no conviction for sin. But Paul's saying here, the very nature of my conviction tells me the law is good. Feeling convicted means that the law is good. Why? Because it brings me to Christ. It doesn't drive me farther away from God. Well, preacher, I don't like feeling convicted. Well, listen, the only way you can not feel convicted is either get so seared in your conscience that you can't stand the things of God or get right. And thank God, let me tell you something, if you can't get convicted any longer, you're in a bad spot. That's a bad place to be. So the very nature of our conviction, Paul's saying, listen, the very nature of me saying I shouldn't do that, I was wrong for doing that, I'm saying that the law of Moses, the law of God, is good. The very nature proclaims that God's, the very nature of conviction proclaims that the law of God is good and it is working. Then he says, in verse 21 through 23, there are two more laws I have to deal with. Look at verse 21. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. He's not referring to the law of God there. But look what he says in verse number 22. For I delight in the law of God. There's that verse. That's referring back to the law of God. After the inward man. But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. So Paul's saying there's some laws here going on we have to understand about people. There's a law of God that says, thou shalt not, the Ten Commandments and all the things that God says. Then he says, the law of my mind, that's the spiritual part of me that wants to serve God. And my mind says, hey, Paul, serve God. Hey, Paul, do what's right. If you want to picture how the world pictures it, it's that little white angel on your shoulder that's saying, don't do that. That's the law of the mind. But then he says, there's another law in my members. That's that other guy on the other side, the red guy on the other side, that's saying, don't listen to the white guy over there. He's no fun. So this law of my members, it also wars against the law of my mind, so I can't do the things that I want to. They fight against each other. I struggle with them, and my flesh is always battling against my will to do what's right. Now, so there's the three laws. We see three laws here. The law of God, that's settled. We're not going to change that. There's the law of the mind that says, serve God. Follow him faithfully. Do what he says. Then the law of our flesh, the law of our members that say, the law of sin that says, but you can't serve God. And it's what you should do to have more fun and enjoy yourself. And doing what God says is will ruin your life. And do what you want to do. That's the law, the battle of the wills here that goes on. Now, there are two other laws. There are two other laws greater than the laws of the mind and of sin. The law of the mind says this, you just try harder. Now, let me ask you a question. How does that work for people? When you just try harder. Just, you know what? If you just try harder as a person, you could probably do right and be righteous before God. And the law of the mind sometimes gets us messed up that way. But there's two other laws that are greater than the law of the mind and the law of sin. No matter how hard that you try, you're not of your own accord. You're not going to win the battle over their wills yourself. Look with me at Romans 7, verse 25. Watch this first law. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So that with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, with the flesh, the law of sin. The context continues and says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Now watch this next law. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. Here's what Paul's saying. Here's what the Word of God's saying. You must be born again. The battle over the wills is not fleshly, it's spiritual. To get to a place where you can say, I will serve God, and then do it, is not my flesh trying harder, it's me being saved. It's me walking in the Spirit of God. Look what verse number 3 says. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through this flesh, God sending his son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned a sin in the flesh. That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. It says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. You're never going to bring yourself under the law of God. You can't make yourself righteous. You're not going to win this battle by yourself. Verse number 8 says, so then they that are in the flesh cannot please God, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. Paul is saying this is a spiritual battle that takes place. If you're going to win, you've got to yield to the law of the Spirit. What's that? That's being born again. That's being born again. It's also walking in the Spirit. Now, how do we as people access or walk in the Spirit of God and, of course, be born again? Well, there's another law that brings that up. Look with me at Romans chapter 3. I hope this all is kind of clicking together. Romans chapter 3 and verse number 23. Look at the scripture. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There's your dilemma. Man is stuck in sin. And so if we all sin and come short of the glory of God, there's nothing in ourselves that can, of course, make us righteous or cause us to win the battle of the wills. Verse number 24. Being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath sent forth to be a propitiation through the faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say, that at this time his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus, whereas boasting then is excluded. By what law? There's that word again. By what law? Of works? No. Nay, but by the law of faith. There's two laws greater than the law of the mind and the law of the flesh. The law of the Spirit and the law of faith. For us to get the victory over the battle of the wills requires, first of all, for us to be born again. Now, that's pretty easy to understand tonight. Most of us tonight, if I ask if you were born again, you'd say yes. The law of the Spirit gives us victory over this battle of the wills. Paul didn't say, I got this battle of the wills. I want to do right. I will to do right. But then I find myself doing the wrong thing. How dumb can I be? You ever feel that way? You ever give in? Battle of the will, you give in to it. And you do whatever you've been tempted to do. And at the end of the day, you're like, why did I do that? I am so dumb. You ever set out? You know, that's how diets are, battle of the wills. It's amazing how strong the will to eat is. Right? Man, you get up on the morning time, you're like, all right, this is the day. Today is the day I'm starting. And within 6 months, I'm going to be 50 pounds lighter. And then, you know, you start out good, man. You're like, I'm doing a good job. And you behave yourself for breakfast, a small little snack in the middle, and a nice lunch. You got a salad and salmon, you know. You get your omega-3s and your vegetables in there, a little bit of protein along the way. And then come about 8 o'clock at night, there's a monster that just raises up inside of you. This huge, monstrous will that says, you don't want to be skinny because they're not happy. Skinny folks are angry and mean. The fat folks are happy. They can't get anywhere, but they're happy. And all of a sudden, you find yourself with a bowl of ice cream. Right? Syrup on it, caramel. Next day, you get up, you get on the scale, you're like, why in the world? You tell me I can't lose 1 pound, fat guy? 1 pound? You can't lose 1 pound? And boy, it's the battle of the wills. And our idea is, we got to try harder, right? No, you got to change. There's nothing you got to change. And this is the same way with sin. It's just not, I'm going to try harder, because you understand. You know, I try to tell young people, and try to be polite about it and be appropriate. This thing about romance and the desire to be with somebody is bigger than most people can handle. That's why God said to Adam, it's not good for men to be alone. Do you think God was worried about Adam having clean leaves to wear? No. Listen, I can hire my leaves to get cleaned. No. God knew there's a desire in a man to be with a woman and vice versa. And then sometimes, listen, why do you think the world today is so crazy on sex? It's that battle of the wills. And by the way, you can't tell me the world, even the world today, not being saved, can shack up and not feel like I've done something wrong. The very law of nature says you're living like an animal. So there's this battle of the wills that takes place. And God says if you're going to win this spiritual battle, it, first of all, it takes place by being born again, walking in the Spirit of God. It takes place by having faith in Christ Jesus. Look with me at the book of Romans 8 again. Let me read you a few more verses here. Now, here's what happens. When we live by the law of faith, when we live by the law of the Spirit, Christ changes our position and our practice. Look at Romans 8, verse number 8. It says, so then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. That's our position. When you get saved, Christ changes your position in Christ. Look at verse number 10. If Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus Christ from the dead dwell in you. He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh. But if you live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the flesh, ye shall live. So Christ, walking in the Spirit of God, the law of the Spirit, the law of the faith, it alters our position. Where are we at now as believers? Where? In Christ. I'm in Christ. That's a great place to be. Because I'm secure that I can say I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. So he changes my position. I'm safe and secure in Christ. I'm saved. I'm sealed. I'm sanctified. I'm justified in Christ. But now my position's changed. Now with him working within me, he's going to change my practice. Change my practice. It's like having a fitness guy with you 24/7 that says, don't open that refrigerator. Fat boy, run, fat boy, run. Right? Now let's put this in practice tonight. Look at me at the book of 1 Timothy chapter 6, please. Let's see if you don't mind. Are you with me so far?
Yeah.
All right. Let's look at this at a practical application. 1 Timothy chapter number 6. And verse number 6. We're going to see this in this battle of the wills, how to win the battle of the wills in application. How's it practical? Because we can say, walk in the Spirit all day long. If we don't know how to apply it, come the end of the day, we're at the refrigerator with ice cream running down our chin. When I was, you know the best way to have ice cream? Don't even dish it out. Keep a spoon in the bowl in the freezer. Just put it right there in the big container. Put a spoon right in there. So when you open it up, you just it's your bowl. The whole thing is yours. And then in that background, you hear the song, Come and Dine, Fat Boy, Come and Dine. Look at verse number 6. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and certainly we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be there with content. Now watch this. But they that will be rich. There's that battle of the wills again. But they that will be rich fall into temptation, and a snare, into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which draw men into destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some have coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. The battle of the wills. When we lose that battle, and we chase the world's desires, we chase the lust of the flesh, God says, you're going to pierce yourself through with many sorrows. It's not going to end well. Look at verse 11 now. Here's the application. But thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I charge thee in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me give you tonight four words in practical application how to win the battle over the flesh. Number one is this. Flee. Flee. Flee the will of the flesh. Verse 11 says, but thou, O man of God, flee these things. Tonight, I think that's one of the biggest keys to winning the battle over the will, the choice to do wrong. He says, listen, Paul, he said, Timothy, when you face the desire to be rich, to have, to gain, to get more stuff, to chase silly dreams that matter, that don't make a difference, to chase material things. Timothy, when you face these things, he says, run from them. Get away from them. Boy, tonight, that's, I think, a good key to application about walking in the Spirit of God and living by faith is to run from the things that pull us contrary from the Word of God. Run the other way. Run from the enticer of the will. Whatever entices your will to make the wrong choices, you must run from that influence. The TV has an off button. Turning off is running the other way. The cell phone has an off button. You don't have to download social media to your cell phone. I know I've harped on this over and over again, but I think one of the greatest hindrances to our folks being spiritual today is social media. It entices the will to do wrong. There's advertisements on there. There's junk on there. There's all these so-called, well, they're good Christians and they can do. Well, how do you know by a picture on a cell phone that they're good Christians? And their life that they're trying to plaster on social media isn't as happy as what they look like. So we have to flee from these influences to do wrong. You have to be vigilant because we think that whatever we want to do, then it must be okay. If we will it, it must be all right. No, you can't trust your will either. You see, there's that battle between doing right and doing wrong. So you must flee youthful lust. You must run from them. Run from wrong people. Run from wrong people. Listen, here's something. If you think you have to have a social media, not everybody has to be your friend. You're not a better person if you have 5 million friends. Besides, you might have a bunch of likes, but you don't have very many friends anyway. Nobody likes you. That was supposed to be a little funny, but a little sarcasm there. That fell kind of flat. It's hurtful, is it? It's hurtful. You better be careful of the wrong kind of friends. You have to run from the wrong kind of jobs. There are some jobs, when taking out of the house of God, wrong job. Preacher, I'm going to move for a job. You better be careful. Is there a church there? Well, when we get there, we'll find one. You better find one before you get there. If there's not one there, it's probably not God leading to that place. Well, we'll just travel. No, you won't. You might travel someplace for an hour or two, you know, a few weeks. But many Americans, we're too lazy to travel 2 hours every week to a church place. It's hard to get folks to travel 30 minutes to church, let alone 2 hours and be involved somewhere. Be careful of those things. Hey, run from the wrong entertainment. Right? You know, there are sometimes we're content with what we have, and we see advertisements. Well, my wife don't look like that. My husband doesn't act like that. Listen, tell you something, ma'am. They're paid to act that way. If you pay me, I'll act that way too. Well, I wouldn't. Sometimes I wouldn't act that way. Wrong thing to say. Hey, flee the will of the flesh. Number two, follow after the will of God. Verse number 11 says this of our text, but though a man of God flee these things, follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Here's what God wants us to pursue. This word follow means pursue hard after. It's the same thing as a man cleaving to a woman. He pursues her, right? Cleaving. He's saying the same thing. Follow after. Cleave to that which is good. Follow after. Pursue hard after righteousness. Listen, let me say something. Church, you can't be too righteous. You can't have too much love. You can't have too much, well, I'm just a preacher. I don't want to be too godly. What? What's wrong with that? Well, I won't fit in. That's okay. You'll fit in with the right person then. What is that? Listen, God, do I fit in with you? There's a lot of Christians going to get to heaven by the skin of their teeth. Like I kind of feel like, I don't fit in right here real well. Thank God that he's going to change us, right? But if he didn't change us, we'd get to heaven like, well, I don't really fit in here. I don't really know anybody hardly. And boy, they're doing things that we don't like doing. Follow after. Pursue after faith. Pursue after love. Pursue after, here we go, patience. He said this, preacher, if I pursued those things, I'd be a big sissy. No, you'd be godly. Well, I'm going to pursue after being tough and rough. He said, pursue meekness. Imagine that. A church of independent fundamental Baptist men who are meek. Okay. Wah, wah, wah. Number three. Let me just say this. If I'm pursuing the will of God, I won't be detoured by the actions of others. Don't you get sick of that sometimes of yourself? Well, they did, so-and-so did something, so I'm done. Well, who are you pursuing? Who are you following after? Well, they did me wrong. Yep. Who did you do wrong? Who did you offend? Right? If I'm pursuing the will of God, I will find myself in good company. Number three is the word, I got to go on here. I got 3 minutes because I want to get you out of here by 7. Because ice cream is at home. Number three is fight. Fight the good fight of faith. Verse number 12 says this, fight the good fight of faith. Christian, tonight, I'm going to tell you something. We want a life of convenience and comfort. But God says this, fight. He says, listen, faith, the fight of faith is a good fight. It's a good fight. Faith is a fight, and faith is a good fight. Let me hold your place in Timothy here. You got to see one other verse here. Turn back to 1 Corinthians chapter number 9. Paul didn't, when Paul said, a worse man than I am, he didn't say, I'm giving up. I'm done. I'm just going to send my life. Ooh, I'm sending my life away. He didn't say that. A little side note there. I won't sing anymore. I'm sorry. Lester Olaf sang good songs. I sing terrible songs. There's that will of the flesh again. I wanted it right. Look what he says in 1 Corinthians 9:24. It says in verse number 24, know ye not that they which run the race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. There's that fighting again. Verse number 25, and every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now, by the way, that song wouldn't have bothered you if you didn't know what it was. Right? Yeah, it wouldn't have bothered you at all. You're like, what's he singing? But some of you knew what I was singing, right? Yeah, hypocrite, don't judge me. Okay, verse number 25. And every man that striveth, I don't know why Abilene was laughing. She didn't even know that. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know why the other day I was driving along, I thought of Eddie Rabbit. What a weird thing to think about. Verse 25. And every man that striveth against for the master is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. Now watch verse number 26 and 27. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. Now watch it. Did not he say, I battle my wills? Look what he says now. But I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Paul didn't say this. He didn't say, you know what, my wills, I'm battling my wills, and I want to do what's right, and I the things I hate that I do, I'm just going to give up and do what I want to do as I please. No, he said, I'm going to keep my body under subjection to the things of God. I'm going to fight the good fight of faith. Lest when I preach to other people about the gospel, I myself become a castaway. I don't want to backslide. I don't want to live in the flesh. So he tells Timothy, Timothy, you fight the good fight of faith. Flee youthful lust. Run from it. Follow after godliness. And Timothy, he says, fight. Fight. He says, because of faith, I run in a determined direction. Because I don't just run haphazardly anywhere. I point myself to the goal line. I have a goal in mind, the will of God, and I run that direction. If you're running away from youthful lust, where should you be running to? You're actually running to the things of God. He says, because of faith, I fight with discipline. I don't just go out there and box the air. I don't just go out there and just throw some punches. I have discipline. Because of faith with God's help, I fight against the law of sin. I fight against the flesh. I fight against wrong thinking. I fight against the will of sin. This is a fight of surrender to God. Saying, God, let you have your way with me. I fight from keeping from being a castaway. Christian, tonight, can I encourage you tonight? When those battle of wills take place, walk in the Spirit of God. Whatever is enticing the will, run. That means get away from the computer. Put the phone down. Turn the TV off. Change the music. Change the channel. But run from that enticement to do evil. Hey, decide, I'm going to pursue the things of God. Righteousness, godliness, faith, and patience, and love, and meekness. I'm going to fight. I'm going to go down swinging. Because I don't want to be a backslider. I don't want to give my life to preach the gospel, then myself become a castaway. Let me tell you something. If you give into the will of the flesh, you better mark the direction you're going. Where will it end? Don't become a shipwreck. Don't become a shipwreck. Then lastly, number four is this. So we got flee, follow, fight. Number four is this, the last word, faithfulness. Paul said to Timothy in chapter 6, verse number 14, he said, that thou keepest commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He didn't say this until Sunday evening. Until the next revival meeting. Until you don't feel like it. He said, Timothy, you flee and follow and fight. You be faithful. You be sold out until you see Christ. Let me tell you something. Our biggest enemy, my biggest enemy tonight is not folks in the pew. It's not the folks in the world, by the way. It's not even the devil. Though he's real, my biggest enemy is myself. My flesh, and I'll be glad one day when I get a brand new body. Do you ever get tired of yourself? Like, why in the world do I have those kind of desires? There are sometimes I wake up from a dream like, why in the world do I dream this stuff? What is my subconscious possessed? This is crazy stuff that you think about. Battle of the mind. The battle of the wills. You wake up in the morning. I'm going to serve God today. I'm going to charge health a squirt gun if I have to. But I'm going to serve God today. And then by the end of the day, you're like, oh, I don't want to send the Christian in my life. No more church. No more Christians. No more people. I'm going to just get a tent somewhere and go live in the woods by myself. But there's no ice cream in the woods by yourself. Yeah. That's too much work too. Let me say this tonight in closing. faithfulness allows you to see the glory of God. Look at verse number 15 of our text, lastly, 1 Timothy 6. Which in times past he shall show, who is a blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. You know why, folks, tonight, we pride ourselves way too much on who we think we are. Our strengths, our opinions, our intellect, our talents. We think too highly of ourselves. And we miss the glory of God. We're too impatient. Too big in a hurry. We're too sleepy. We're too non-involved. And we're too unfaithful at times. And in doing so, when we follow our will, we miss the glory of God. But when you're faithful until the end, until his appearing, in that time, and in God's time, by being faithful, God reveals to you, this side of heaven, by the way, his glory. Hey, he said, listen, I'm the only potentate. I'm the only King of kings and Lord of lords. And I have what you need, and I'll be with you. Just be faithful. So how do you apply the law of the Spirit and the law of faith? What does it look like in application? Well, if I'm going to practice it, it means when youthful lusts come, I'm going to run. I'm going to pursue after the things of God. I'm going to fight. I'm going to swing and fight and serve God. I'm going to just fight the good fight of faith. And then I want to commit, God, with your help, I'm going to be faithful until I see you face to face. Lord, tonight, help us, I pray, in the battle of the wills. The will to do right, make the right choices, to act right, behave right. We find ourselves oftentimes in that battle of the wills, telling ourselves, just one more won't hurt. Just one more time. Just one more look. One more listen. One more taste. And oh, Father, before long, we are just way back in up to our necks in sin. Help us tonight, I pray, to take the application tonight and apply it to our life that we may have spiritual victory. We pray in your name and ask. Let's all tonight stand together. Piano player comes and begins to play an invitation song tonight. Tonight, how's it with you in your life? Have you been fleeing youthful lust, running from those things? Running from the wrong people, the wrong influences? Have you been pursuing after God, pursuing righteousness and godliness and faith and patience and meekness? Pursue those things. Have you been fighting the good fight of faith? Are you being faithful tonight? Have you committed? Lord, I'm going to, by your help, be faithful until I see you, Father, face to face. In doing so, I believe that we'll see the glory of God in our life. Battle of the wills. Paul recognized that. He closed chapter 7 with, "O wretched man that I am." But he began chapter 8 with, "But I've got victory in Jesus Christ. I'm in Christ. I've got victory." One last stanza tonight, if you need to come, would you come this evening? The battle of the wills. Thank you, ma'am. Let me close the night with this thought. Serving God or serving self is always a choice. As a Christian, we have no excuse. We can't say, the devil made me do it. It was too hard. I just couldn't do it. No, God's given us some applications tonight. If we apply them to our lives, we will always, always be victorious. It's not in the Christ. It's not in. It's not the problem. Is not in the Word, or in God. The problem is us not applying it, and being speedily about it. He didn't say, "Hey, hang around then for a while, then run." He said, "No, you run. Immediately, you run." I think that's one of the biggest keys, is just running away from those things and pursuing godliness. Lord, tonight we come to you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for your word tonight. I know, Lord, it's been a little weighty. And Lord, Father, I pray that you does this, give us enlightenment, Father, through the Spirit of God. Lord, that this battle of the wills can be won. And Lord, through the Spirit of Christ and walking in the Spirit of God and making an application of your word, we can have great victory, Father. So with the things that we don't want to do, we won't do. The things that we do want to do for Christ's sake, Lord, we can find ourselves doing those things. Help us, I pray, God, to surrender to you, we pray tonight in your name. Amen. See you on Wednesday night, Lord willing.